David Kay. In this chapter, we answer the question, what are good uses, and what are some not-so-good uses of machine learning? This is an important question right now. I hear from a lot of people who tell me their service executive has come up to them and said, why don't we just take that artificial intelligence system, the one Jeopardy, have it read all our materials, then we can replace all our agents and save a bundle. There's just one problem with this. It doesn't work. We're still a long way away from being able to replace humans for general purpose tasks, like dealing with whatever random questions our customers have. So if the technology isn't ready for that, what can it do? First, if you can just buy a product that's being used by lots of other companies, it's a pretty safe bet that it can work for you too. In the world of service, those products tend to be the new generation of chatbots, the new generation of machine learning search engines, and tools for sentiment analysis, trying to figure out if a customer's upset, and if so, how our agent is managing the conversation. And there are more coming all the time. That's not to say it doesn't take work to make these products work for you, especially chatbots. But if you want to solve one of those problems, you probably can, and you should strongly consider buying one of those tools. What if you're trying to do something new and innovative? Then I have 5 criteria that your problem needs to pass before trying machine learning. Number 1, have high quality data. Have lots and lots of high quality data. We haven't talked about these technologies yet, but as a rule of thumb, you need at least thousands of data points for simpler statistical methods and hundreds of thousands of data points for neural networks or deep learning approaches. For some of the approaches we'll discuss, you really need not only the input, but the output too. That is, what answer should the algorithm have returned? The machine's answers will only be as good as the answers you use to train. Number 2, the input data has more or less all the relevant information. There was a machine learning effort to determine what led to better medical outcomes for patients who came to the hospital with pneumonia. The algorithm decided that patients with asthma, as well as pneumonia, had better outcomes. Of course, this is absurd. You don't want patients to come in sicker. What really happened is that the patients with both these conditions were always admitted straight to the ICU, which gave them more treatment, which led to better outcomes. The problem is, no one thought to tell the computer about the ICU. Number 3, failure has to be an option. These algorithms don't always work, and sometimes they can fail in surprising ways. Data scientists have created images that look like a blur to a human, but the computer identifies as a cup or a fork with great confidence. If you need perfection, AI isn't there yet. Number 4, make sure the task is one of the things that algorithms are good at. We'll go over these in detail later in the course, but just to take one example, machine learning is good at classifying, taking input data and deciding, is it one of these or one of those? For example, is this picture a delicious blueberry muffin or an adorable chihuahua? It's harder than it looks. This is how a chatbot seems like it's talking with you. It takes your words and classifies them into one kind of question or another, and it has a response for each of those questions. So if it correctly classifies what you write, you'll get a helpful and sensible answer. Finally, it has to be important. There are ever better tools, and we're learning more every day, but it's not easy. There needs to be enough return, financial or otherwise, to justify the investment of using AI and ML. With that, you now know whether these amazing technologies can help solve your problem. In the next chapter, we'll talk about specific examples of what AI can and cannot do for customer service.